Gonna go for the cover. Doesn't realize that Bobby Lashley, though, was back up to his feet. He's not gonna be able to get the dub there. Bobby Lashley. Uh-oh. Oh! Gonna go for the Dominator. He's gonna go for the 1-2-3. Hoping. Hey, oh! It's your boy, Mr. Faith, and this is WWE How It Should Be, episode 26. I hope everyone is doing as good as this episode is surely going to be, because trust me, we have a good one in store for you tonight, alright? As always, timestamps are in the video, so feel free to skip to matches if you like, or just watch the main event, or however you enjoy your wrestling. It's entirely up to you. On the card, we have a triple threat match. Eric from the Viking Raiders, of course. Kane and Randy Orton are all facing off. Samoa Joe is getting another chance at the 24/7 title, or a chance to earn it back, I should say, from Six. And, of course, we are continuing our series of the Fatal 4 matches for the number one contender for Brock Lesnar. Tonight is the powerhouse edition. I mean, we got Batista, Braun Strowman, Bobby Lashley, and Drew McIntyre. Wait, what's that? Oh, you didn't know that Samoa Joe lost his 24/7 title? Oh, you didn't even know we were having Fatal 4-Way matches to determine a number one contender. Wow. That can be embarrassing. I get it. But don't worry. All of these videos are put in a nice, convenient playlist for you. The link is in the description, so feel free to check that out, you know. Watch from the beginning. Get caught up, so that way you can get yourself right. You know what I'm saying? That being said, though, we're not going to waste any more of your guys' time tonight. We're getting straight into the show. This is Monday Night Raw, and it starts right now. All right. Starting us off, man. A nice, compelling, as Michael Cole said, a nice, compelling triple threat match. This one goes, I mean, basically all the way back to the beginning of the series, right? We stripped RK-Bro. You know, we unified the tag team titles on the main card. We stripped RK-Bro of their titles and just gave it all to the Usos, you know. And that wasn't right, so we had a title match. But then, you know, Miz and Morrison started stealing the show, and they kind of worked themselves in, so the title match became a triple threat, where Riddle did eventually get pinned. But honestly, I mean, it could have been, you know, he got hit with the Starship Pain, and then he got hit with the Uso Splash, like, back-to-back, right? So it's like, you can't really blame them for losing that one. It could have been anybody. What's going on here, though? I'm sorry, I'm trying to keep it professional, but what was that we just witnessed? RK Bro loses, but they don't really lose like in the most devastating way, right? And then the Viking Raiders come out and they're like, hey, you know, you guys need to get to the back of the line, right? You had your shot, you lost. It doesn't really matter how you lost, you gotta get it back to the line, make room for new tag teams, right? And they have a point. RK Bro is like, yo, you know, we have a point too, right? So they have a match, SummerSlam. RK-Bro wins. But then afterwards, you know, there's a little hostility along the way. They break out the chairs. They go out the Viking Raiders some more. Then the next night on Monday Night Raw, they come out. You know, they say, hey, no tag team in this division can tell us that we don't belong at the top, that we got to get to the back of the line, blah, 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 blah. And then Kane and Undertaker come out, make their return, their debut, whatever. And, you know, shock everybody, right? They have a match impromptu style. Of course, Kane and Undertaker win. And then the following week, Kane and Undertaker are in a match, and Randy Orton comes out with the distraction. You know, so there's just a lot going on here, right? There we go. A lot going on between these three teams. And, you know, nothing really for the tag team titles or anything. But, you know, it kind of all starts and is based around the fact that, you know, RK-Bro doesn't want to get to the back of the line. Eric and Ivar think that they deserve a shot, that they need to, you know, that they're next in line. And which is part of the reason why they have a problem with, you know, Kane and Undertaker making a return and just all of a sudden, you know, they're getting an opportunity, right? They're not having to wait like Eric and Ivar had to. But then again, Kane and Undertaker are coming back and like, hey, man, we're going to put all of you guys back in your place, right? So, you know, we're going to prove why RK-Bro needs to go to the back of the line and why we can skip you guys in line. You know what I'm saying? I mean, so, it's a very interesting dynamic. And we've it's led to a lot of this. So, of course, you know, we're coming up to Clash of Champions in a few episodes, and it just seems right to have this match, you know, as tensions are building. I don't know if we'll have a match between all the teams or not at Clash of Champions, but it'll definitely be something to, I don't know, maybe test out. Yeah, we'll see how this match goes. If this match is continues to be as entertaining as it's been so far, to be honest. Oh! Then who knows? We might have it. Eric going for the cover. Oh, I thought he was going to get that for a second there. Randy Orton, he's in a dangerous place. But isn't he always? You know what I'm saying? Uh-oh. Uh-oh. Oh! Good belly-to-belly suplex. Kane, though, rising in the corner. Kane in the ring. Randy Orton doesn't see him. Oh, it looked like he was about to catch him with a chokeslam. Randy Orton sees him out of the corner of his eye last second. What's he got in mind here? Got him stacked up in the corner. Oh, Irish whip. Kane right in Eric there. Oh, what do we got here? Headlock from Randy Orton. Vintage. Uh-oh. RKO. Oh. But yeah, he didn't see Eric getting up. He had no chance. But Eric, what are you doing? You can't do that. You can't just break up Randy Orton and think that you can just go taunt to the crowd and hype yourself up. Oh. I thought Randy Orton was reversing that to an RKO for a second. That's why I was like, oh. Randy Orton able to kick out yet again, showing a lot of resilience. Uh-oh. 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 What we got going on here? Oh! Okay, why did he say the trachea? Like, just, I don't know the way he said that. All right. Oh! Showing all the strength Eric is. But Randy Orton thought he was lying in wait, but Eric saw it coming. Eric looking to be somehow in firm control of this match, believe it or not. Oh! Nice little stunner across the top rope. Now action is spilled to the side of the ring here. And now him and Eric going after each other. Oh! Yo, Randy Orton is it's not like he's been doing the most devastating maneuvers, but he's been doing the properly impactful move, I should say, at the right time. Like, just the timing for him has been pretty good in this match. If he keeps it up, I could see him winning the whole thing. Kane, though, with that. Oh! With a skull into the ring post. Uh-oh. What's Randy Orton got in mind here?
He climbs into the ring.
Nothing, apparently. He says, I'm done. I'll let you guys go at it as I soak up the crowd. Oh! That neck breaker by Kane. I like that. That's a swift one, too. But here we go, though. Randy Orton says, no, sir, Bob. Oh! A German suplex from Randy Orton? Oh. But Kane, though. You can't keep Kane down. Oh. Okay, maybe that'll keep him down for a little bit. Randy Orton. Gonna take him over to the ropes, I think. Oh, no, to the corner. Oh, what's he looking for here? Oh, no. Oh, no.
What is Orton doing? What is he thinking?
Anything he wants.
Is he thinking an RKO from the top rope? From the top turnbuckle while Kane is laid out in front of us here at the announce table? Can he capitalize on it, though? This is the question. He rolls him over. He gets the leg picked up. One. Two, it's gotta be over. No one's gonna survive the RKO from the top rope, folks. And Randy Orton, like I tell you, the timing. I mean, what I tell you, huh? You know, the timing of Randy Orton throughout that entire match was just absolutely impeccable. I mean, he did all the big moves when he should have. And, you know, he proved that he could hit that RKO out of nowhere. But also, I mean, when he saw the window of opportunity to end the match, he hit that RKO from the top rope and... from the top turnbuckle. Easy 1-2-3. But on to this match, though. Sorry, I just kind of was soaking in the action there. In case you missed last episode of Friday Night SmackDown, Samoa Joe lost his 24/7 title against Six. And as we were saying, you know, Six has made a career of getting those surprising upset victories, right? You know, the 1-2-3 kid. I mean, that's just how his whole thing, right? You know, he's never really the guy to win, but somehow still ends up winning anyways. And Samoa Joe came out and, you know, toyed with him a little bit. He had him a Kukina clutch at one point, you know, ended up letting out of it. And, you know, he ended up paying for it. I mean, he tried to get the, you know, the Kukina clutch locked in the second time, and Six was able to counter it, slip out, and, you know, get the dub. And, you know, Samoa Joe, I mean, he came in my office. He's pretty upset, you know, and he's a pretty intimidating man. So I said, all right, we'll give you another shot. And hey, don't judge me. All right, you would give Samoa Joe another shot too if he came into your office. He was as mad as you. You didn't see him. You guys weren't there. All right, and my security was gone. It was just me and Joe, and I was pretty sure that the only way I was ever gonna make it out of the room was to give him another shot. So here we are. Samoa Joe challenging Six at 24/7 title, wanting it back. I mean, you can see since the start of the series that 24/7 title has just become more and more coveted. I mean, put William Regal on the map. Granted, we haven't really seen him since. You know, inspired the return of JBL, even though he didn't even ever have a match with the 24/7 title. Inspired the return of Boogeyman, who was so scary that he didn't even have to defend the title for dang near a month. You know, able to see Omos and Dominik Dijakovic and just a lot of good people, a lot of good talent. You know, Brian Cage from Lucha Underground came in, definitely put him on the map and in the picture. So, I mean, and he didn't even win the title. So, you know, just being involved in a good match with the 24/7 champ, putting people on the map. But Samoa Joe, he's got a lot to prove. I mean, he's trying to tell the world that he's not washed. You know what I'm saying? That he isn't looking to go on one last run, but that he's at the height of his career. And I think that loss to Six on Friday, you know, really hurt him. It really hurt him. And, of course, I say Friday's in Friday Night SmackDown. I don't know if it actually aired on Friday for you guys. Oh, yeah, he's going to pay for that. When you're in the ring with Samoa Joe, you can't afford to have the miss. But Six... Six still able to slide out of trouble. He's a slippery son of a gun, isn't he? Yeah. Oh, I like that. I like that a lot. But Six still showing the fight. Still trying to slip out of trouble. Oh, successfully slipping out of trouble, if you ask me. Definitely putting his elusiveness on display. I mean, look at him, huh? Every time you think he might be in trouble, he's not. Going straight for the cover. Samoa Joe barely kicking out, huh? Wow. Six. Uh-oh. Looking for... Oh! Yeah. He lands it. Uh-oh. Uh-oh. Now he's looking to get in it. Yeah. Yeah, the same move he won the title with. He's looking to seal the deal here tonight. The crossface chicken wing. Samoa Joe, I don't think he has a choice. Yeah. He's got to tap out again. Wow. Wow. Six. You know, making his debut a little bit later than I thought he would, but making his debut. Someone already busted open here? Wait a second. Bobby Lashley already bleeding from the forehead? Oh, my goodness. Six, though. I mean, back to the... What we just saw, right? I mean, that's impressive. Samoa Joe held that title for a few weeks. And Six shows up, makes his debut a little bit later than intended, but Samoa Joe's been submitting people with the Kukina clutch. He's been absolutely toying with people on this run. Six comes out, slips out of the clutch, gets him in the crossface chicken wing, and gets the dub. Then... he goes on the aggressive. He attacks Samoa Joe some more. knowing it was going to anger Samoa Joe, knowing Samoa Joe would request a rematch, which he gladly gave to him, and then he beat him with the crossface chicken wing again. Samoa Joe been making ninjas tap the whole time, and now he's getting tapped out twice in a row. I mean, talk about a statement. You know what I'm saying? Already, Six's run with the 24/7 title is more impressive than Samoa Joe's was, right? You have to think. I mean, he definitely one-upped them so far. But that's all speculation, right? Let's focus on the match at hand. This is actually a semi-important match here. Number one contendership on the line, of course, not here in this particular match. But the winner of this match will then go into a five-man match that the winner of that match will then be named the number one contender for Brock Lesnar at Hell in a Cell. So far, Hulk Hogan and Ric Flair have been winners of their Fatal 4-Way matches. So, you know, big names already in the hat. And, I mean, these guys are all looking to, you know, add their names to that list, right? I mean, you know, all of these guys have tasted gold before in the past. Bobby Lashley, I think, being the most recent of them all. And so, of course, you know, they all want to get back to the top, right? If you ask me, though, this is an interesting time, I think. I mean, if I'm a WWE superstar, you know, you always want to compete for a championship. Don't get me wrong. I mean, I wouldn't turn down an opportunity, but, you know, I don't think that I would necessarily be chomping at the bit to be champion right now, knowing that there's a money in the bank. A Money in the Bank briefcase out there, you know, waiting to be cashed in. Yeah, you know you're in trouble when you're in that corner with Batista and those, you know, shoulders that he can deliver. Batista, though, showing his age a little bit, right? Having to take that breath after delivering that sidewalk slam. And then, oh! Braun Strowman able to take advantage, realizes it's just him and Batista in the ring. Delivers the power slam. Gonna go for the cover. Doesn't realize that Bobby Lashley, though, was back up to his feet. He's not going to be able to get the dub there. Bobby Lashley. Uh-oh. Oh! Going to go for the Dominator. He's going to go for the 1-2-3. Hoping and praying that Batista couldn't get to his feet in time, but alas, he could. Oh! Going to go for that Dominator. Oh, wait. That was the Dominator, what he did before to Braun Strowman? Wasn't the Dominator? I'm so confused. Looks like he's looking for a... Uh-oh. Again, another Dominator here. What is that? Like a kill switch? I don't even know what that is. But he's going for the win. Oh, and he could have had it there, too. But Braun Strowman, able to kick out. Bobby Lashley was this close to moving on. One step closer to being number one contender, but couldn't quite seal the deal there. I mean, look at this. Oh, and he just drops Batista on his skull, and then Batista collides with Braun Strowman, and Braun Strowman is dazed. Oh, and these guys, this is just, I mean, you know, this is the powerhouse edition, so you know there's power bombs and dominators and... Oh, power slams galore. Oh! Braun Strowman, though, really putting the power on display, huh? Just picking Drew McIntyre up with one hand and just throwing him down to the mat. Now fighting off the almighty Bobby Lashley. I wish we could actually see their heads, though. You know what I'm saying? Not just their shoulders. Oh! Proving why he truly is the monster among men here. Oh! But Bobby Lashley using those brains. Catching Batista off guard, too. Batista thought he had some time. Oh! Everybody's involved now. Everybody's back in the ring. Ashley's getting hot and heavy at this moment. Nobody wants anything to do with anybody unless it's Bobby Lashley. Oh, here we go. Drew turns his attention to Braun. Batista to Lashley. Lashley throws Batista out of the ring and chases after him. Drew McIntyre. Uh-oh. Oh, oh. It looked like he was looking for that backbreaker. Oh. Is he going to get it? Oh. Uh-oh. A nice neckbreaker by Drew McIntyre there. And he's calling for it. He's calling for the Claymore here. Oh, and he lands it. And Batista and Bobby Lashley tangled up on the outside. They didn't even notice. And Drew McIntyre, one step closer to becoming number one contender. Look at him. He's ecstatic. All right, well, there you have it. That's going to wrap up the episode for us. As you guys can see here, I mean, obviously in real time, you know, or whatever, there's still weeks to be had. But, of course, you know, just in our time, we're pretty much, that's the last Monday Night Raw before Clash of Champions for us. So we'll have NXT, we'll have SmackDown, and then the episode after that is going to be the Clash of Champions episode. And it's likely to be a good one. All of the matches tonight, very compelling. Very good storytelling in them, I think. But let me know what you guys think in the comments of this episode. Let me know what you guys think of, you know, ideas that you guys want to see implemented, or if there's maybe a title or a concept or something you guys want to see. Just let me know so that I can take that in consideration and try to mold this universe for you guys. But really, that's all I have for you, man. Next episode is going to be NXT. I'm sure it's going to be a good one. I think I already got the card put together for you guys. So, you know, should be able to pump this content out for you pretty quick. But, hey, I'll see y'all next time. Until then, though, stay safe. Peace.